Hello everyone. Please do not watch this video if you're not in the mood for something completely disturbing and gross. I am going to recount the worst form of abuse, the worst act of abuse I have ever seen in my entire life. And just for you all in the audience to know, I've had a pretty crappy life. I have been abused a lot in my life. I have not had it easy. People have treated me like crap a lot. And also I've seen horrible things in general in my life, but today I'm going to be telling the story of the absolute worst thing I have ever been a witness to in my life. I have been to 2 emergency psychiatric sessions because of this, and both times the psychologist, it was different psychologists, and both times the psychologist said that they had never seen or heard of any story like this at all. I'm going to tell you the story of the priest that I grew up with, or the priest that took care of me when I was a kid and a teenager. His name was Father Greg Staub, OMV. He was born on June 11th, 1957, and he died on March 1st, 2018. He had an extremely rare neurodegenerative illness called MSA, Multiple Systems Atrophy, also known as Scheidreger syndrome. It's a neurological illness that is incurable and it completely destroys the person. It takes your bones, your muscles, your ability to walk, even your voice. Everything. And there's nothing medical science can do about it. Father Greg Staub was tortured and exploited by his fellow Oblates, by his fellow priests, namely by the priests above him in his order. I'm going to list the names now, the 3 priests that I believe are responsible for what happened to him. They are Father John Weichs, OMV, who is currently in Italy, Father Peter Grover, who is in Boston, Father Jim Walther, who is in Boston, and I'm also going to list the names of priests, the priests that should have been loyal to him, that were more or less at his level in terms of hierarchy. They're priests of about the same rank, and they should have been loyal to him, but they weren't. Their names are Father Larry Darnell, OMV, Father Ed Broom, OMV, Father John Lyons, formerly an OMV, now an FSSP. I have no idea what that acronym stands for. So, Father Greg was born June 11th, 1957, in Cleveland, Ohio, to Mary and William Staub, and he ended up being the 3rd of 9 children. His brothers and sisters in order are Edward, Charles, himself, Catherine, Teresa, Jennifer, Anne-Marie, Mary Jane, John. Please do not confuse his biological brothers, Edward and John, with his co-workers, Edward and John, who should have been faithful or should have been loyal to him, but weren't. And when Father Greg was 1 year old, his family moved to Monroe, Wisconsin, from Cleveland, Ohio, where he spent his childhood. His father was a doctor, and he attended private Catholic school until the 8th grade. And after that, he went to public high school in Monroe, Wisconsin. And after that, he went and obtained a bachelor's degree in philosophy, and then he entered seminary school with the Oblates of the Virgin Mary to become a priest. And I met Father Greg. Oh, he was ordained in 1984. He was ordained. He became a priest In 1984, at the Vatican, he was ordained by Pope John Paul II. He was part of a larger group of guys, a huge group of guys, about 50-something guys, that were ordained on May 31st, 1984, in the Vatican by Pope John Paul II. And his co-workers, Edward Broom and John Lyons, were part of that group that was ordained with him, and they also attended seminary school with him all 4 years. Father Larry Darnell was much older and was there his mentor in the seminary, and so he saw him once in a while. They knew each other. But Greg really went to seminary school all 4 years, all the way through, with Ed Broom and John Lyons. So how did I meet this guy? So I met him on January 12, 2002, at St. Peter Chanel Catholic Church in Hawaiian Gardens, California. At that time, there were four priests staffing that church: Father Ed Broom, Father John Lyons, Father Greg Staub, and then Father Larry Darnell. Father Larry was the head priest. And actually, he's still head priest there to this day. I was going to go to confession that night with Father John, but he was saying Mass. And so I ended up going to confession with Father Greg, and so I just randomly picked the line with the least amount of people, and it happened to be his confessional. And knowing this man has changed the course of my life for good, and there's things that I learned from him, from his situation, that you cannot learn in textbooks, and that you cannot learn normally, because this situation was so rare and so extreme. When I met him, I was really taken aback by the fact that he really knew the religion inside and out, and he had such a gentle but masculine voice. He had a soft, gentle voice, but he did not sound like a homosexual. He did not sound effeminate. And he had so much caring for humanity. He had so much caring for everybody. And I couldn't stand the fact that Father John Lyons was always giving sermons against abortion. He is obsessed with abortion. He never talks about anything except abortion and contraception. So to get away from his homilies, I would always go to see Father Greg in his confessional. And when I was a kid, I would play stupid pranks on him. I would, like, steal his glasses. I would take my pen box and, like, put it over the screen and dump it on his head. One time I showed him the finger for no good reason. They were just stupid preteen jokes. But he took it as humorous, especially because most of the people around St. Peter Chanel were very extreme conservatives, and it was kind of a smothering environment to be in. So I think he found it refreshing and funny to see a 12-year-old acting like a brat. And I just want to get this out of the way. Like I said, I used to give him stupid jokes and stupid pranks, and he was a very understanding person in a lot of ways. But there was one issue on which he really put his foot down. There was one issue where he would really put his foot down, and he was relentless. And that is the issue of the LGBT. He said it from the pulpit several times that homosexuality was wrong, and that homosexuals should not be able to get married. And he also believed that going through a sex change was a bad idea because you are performing unnecessary surgery on your body and you are, like, trying to alter what God gave you. And there was this one time when I was 12 and my brother had just told me the definition of the word faggot. And I had also heard on the news that half of all priests were homosexuals. So I walked into his confessional and I said, "Father Greg, can I ask you something?" And without thinking, he said, "Sure, Alexandra, you can ask me anything." And I said to him, "Are you a faggot?" And that was the end of his good mood. His hands started to shake with anger. He was pissed off. And he looked at me and he said, "No, Alexandra, I am not a faggot. What makes you think that I'm a faggot?" And I told them, because half of all, because I heard a statistic on the news saying that half of all priests are fags. And you are a priest. And therefore, there is a 50-50 chance that you are a faggot. And then he said, well, no, I'm not. And he went into this long discussion with me about how the media wants to make Catholicism look bad. And he was like, at most, 25% of priests are fags. And it's not true that half of us are fags. So please keep that in mind. He was against the gay agenda completely. That was the one thing on which he was unmovable. That was the one thing where he really put his foot down. He put it down hard. So I knew Father Greg for a long time, come July of 2004, and he made the announcement that he had been transferred, he was going to be transferred to a new parish of the OMV down in Argentina. And that really upset me, and it upset a lot of people. And I could tell that Father Greg was not happy to be going away. He had served at St. Peter Chanel for 7 years, and I was very upset. A lot of people were very heartbroken. Father Greg was not happy either, but he said that he felt that he had to go, but he wouldn't say why. He just felt he had to go. And he did speak Spanish, but it was like a third language to him. He learned to speak Italian fluently in seminary school. Like, when he was in seminary school, they slammed him with Italian. Not just him, all the seminarians. They made him learn to speak Italian really well. And so he had learned Spanish as a third language, and so his Spanish was not as good as it could have been. You know what I mean? Like, you could understand him, but it was difficult. And so I was really surprised that they were doing that to him, that they were sending him off to Argentina. And it was a very hard parting for a lot of people, and just don't know how to talk about that time. I don't want to keep repeating myself. But he let me take these photographs of him. And this one right here is a photograph of us on the day of his going away party. Outside of St. Peter Chanel. We kept contact over the phone. I'd tell him about my life and how things were going, school, on and on and on. So I kept talking to him even though he was out in Argentina. My mom would get me these calling cards that were like $5 for 2 hours, something ridiculous like that. And so I would talk to him sometimes over the phone, but once, twice a week I'd talk to him. He knew that I was lonely and that I needed him. And he took really good care of me throughout that time of my life. And he came back to visit St. Peter Chanel in about November of 2006. And I remember we had a get-together at a park. It was not at the church, it was at a park nearby. And when I got there, I saw this huge swarm of people surrounding some guy wearing black, and I didn't know who it was. And I asked this nun, and I was like, where's Father Greg? He said, he's right over there. Where? He's right over there. Do you see that big crowd of people? That's where he is. That's not, doesn't look anything like Father Greg. And I walked past him, not even realizing it was him. I walked back and I said, Father Greg, is that you? He had shrank vertically about 3 inches, and his bone structure was nothing. The pictures I just showed you, like, he didn't look anything like that anymore. He was a shriveled up little prune, and he had lost about 3 inches in height. And I was like, Father Greg, are you okay? And he was like, no, I'm all right. I just lost some weight. Everything's fine. I told him, no, you're not okay. I know that when he was in Argentina, he got food poisoning a grand total of 2 times. And each time it lasted about 3 or 4 days each. So that's not enough to account for the unbelievable transformation. And so he stayed for about a week at St. Peter's, and then he went back to Argentina. And I stopped being Catholic in June of 2007, so we stopped talking. And then I heard that he came back to St. Peter Chanel again in about August, I think about August or September of 2007. And so I went to the rectory and I dropped off all my Catholic stuff with him and I told him, I hate this religion. They don't allow women to have abortions ever. They don't allow women to use contraception ever. this is a shitty, horrible religion. I'm done with it. And that was the last time I ever saw him alive. So years go by. Let me make sure. Yeah. So many years go by. I guess it'd be 2012. I'm 21 and in college. I'm 21 and up at Humboldt State. And I knew he was seriously ill. I guessed Huntington's disease. And I really do pat myself on the back for that one. Because I didn't know about multiple systems atrophy back then. I didn't know it existed. And everybody else was too stupid to see that he was sick to begin with. So I still pat myself on the back for that. So 2012 comes. And I try and contact the OMV, and I don't even remember exactly what happened, but I got some very bad information. I was told Father Greg had multiple systems atrophy, and he passed away. He's dead. And of course, considering how sick he was when I was 16, I believed it. And I told my family that he was dead, and I believed it. I myself believed it. And I went on for about a year believing that he was dead, and then I decided to call to ask where he was buried, and they were like, and then somebody more competent answered the phone. I think they fired the person that told me that he was already dead, or she left, got another job, whatever, she wasn't there anymore. And I heard, oh, he's not dead, he's dying, he's terminally ill, but he's not dead yet. He's actually in Cebu in the Philippines. And I said, oh my god, I was told over a year ago that he was dead. And the woman was like, really? Oh, that's not good. And so I asked for the information of where the parish was and for its phone number, and I got a calling card. And I called him, that's right, I sent him an email first asking if he'd even be willing to talk to me on the phone. He said he would, so I called him in the Philippines. And I could tell that his voice was starting to go. It was getting to be difficult for him to talk, and his voice was just, it was just not the same voice. And I asked him if that was the illness, and out of pride, he lied to me, and he told me that he had had a sore throat, and that it wasn't the MSA taking his voice. He just couldn't emotionally deal with what was happening to him. And at that point, I came to realize that that's why he left St. Peter Chanel, even though he really wasn't happy to leave, and he was going to a country he didn't speak the language, was because he didn't want everybody to watch him shrinking, and people saying, why are you losing weight, you know, and people probably were going to try to give him food to fatten him up, and try and figure out what's wrong with him, and he just didn't want to deal with it. He couldn't deal with the humiliation of people that he had known for years watching his body decompose, so he, watching his body atrophy, and so that's why he went to Argentina. And Father Greg was starting to forget things that he should have been able to remember. There were some things that he remembered like that, and then others that he should have known that he couldn't remember them anymore. And he told me, well, I'd appreciate it if you would tell your family that I'm still alive, but I haven't long, so if you can't, it's not that big of a deal.